Hi everybody, this is our third video in the lab safety series. We're going to look at hazards, more specifically biological, sharps, and physical safety hazards. So it's worth starting with some general safety precautions, and if you've spent any kind of time in any kind of lab, you probably already noticed, but wash your hands, hand hygiene, that's like the number one way to prevent getting any kind of infections. Of course, always wear your PPE, which is your personal protective equipment. So usually gloves at the minimum, masks, gowns, whichever is required. Avoid touching your face, nose, or mouth in the work area. And don't rub your eyes, especially if you have gloves on. Never store food or beverages in a lab refrigerator with reagents or specimens. So your employer really should provide you with a separate refrigerator in the break room for food. Do not let anything hang loose that might get contaminated or caught in equipment or even grabbed by patients. So we don't want long hair, we don't want dangly jewelry and things like that, that even lanyards with name tags, that can be a problem. Always protect your feet from spills, slips, and falling objects. So you want to have non-skid shoes, you want to have things that are usually leather or form of type of leather, something that is a good barrier in case something falls, it doesn't go through your shoe. And of course, basically avoid putting anything in your mouth in the work area. It could be things like, bubble gum or even putting on, chapstick or, messing with your contacts or doing something like that while you're in the work area. So what are the different types of safety hazards? So we have biological, infectious agents. We're going to cover this in that busy video. Physical, wet floors and heavy lifting. Sharps, needles, lancets, broken glass. We're going to cover all of those in this video. And then in the next video, we're going to cover chemicals. So like preservatives and reagents. Radiation, we have radioactive reagents in x-ray equipment. Electrical, we have dangerous high voltage equipment. Fire or explosive, any open flame chemicals that can be explosive, and gases under pressure, such as like oxygen tanks. We are also going to cover latex sensitivity in this video, so just allergic reaction to latex in gloves. So let's start with biohazards. So a biohazard is an infectious material or agent that presents a risk or even a potential risk to the health of the human or animals that are in the lab. Risk is defined as the probability that a health effect will occur after an individual has been exposed to a specified amount of a hazard. So, meaning if you get exposed to the hazard, you might get sick. And that health effect, that risk could even be death. Okay, so that's not off the table there. Bioterrorism agents can be divided into categories A, B, and C, but more specifically, we're going to talk about biosafety levels, so levels of containment, and those are levels 1, 2, 3, and 4. So labs need to do a risk assessment to determine what level of biosafety they are, and if they need specific procedures or equipment to facilitate more biocontainment. So most of your hospital labs, clinic labs, are going to be biosafety level 2. Okay, we're going to go, I'm going to show you all four of them, and then that way you can get an idea of what's what. To contain, we can use biosafety cabinets and biosafety hoods. They are designed to remove potentially harmful particles or infective biologic specimens. They are designed to remove potentially harmful particles in the infective biological specimens. So they can offer various levels of protection depending on the biosafety level needed. They're usually designed with a specific airflow, such as when you manipulate things in that safety cabinet, then anything that gets airborne should be taken up in the airstream and where you're not exposed to it. So this picture here denotes the four levels of biosafety. So biosafety level 1 is what you can think of as your typical student lab. And even some hospital labs could be at that level where you can work on the bench. The microbes that are manipulated there are non-pathogenic, or they are very, very low risk, such as, for example, a non-pathogenic strain of E. coli. And obviously the students do need their gloves on and their lab coats and usually goggles, just because you don't want the risk of splashing in there. But there's no biosafety cabinets. Don't need to autoclave any of this stuff. You just need to dispose of it in proper biohazard. You know, hand washing, decontamination of the area is pretty much all that's required at that level. Biolevel safety 2, as you can see here, then this is more hospital type laboratories, and the specimens that are dealt with are pathogenic, but they're, maybe moderately pathogenic. So they cause disease and they're infecting wounds and things, but usually, handling them or opening a specimen is not going to cause an aerosol that you need to that you would breathe in and get contaminated with. Specimens should be set up in a biosafety cabinet, and usually with the sash down, and the lab techs usually will have their gloves and their lab coats and goggles and things like that on. And you can definitely dispose of these things in a biohazard. Some of the stuff can be autoclaved, but it's not absolutely necessary. Now, with biolevel safety 3, this is when everything would have to be autoclaved for safety. You work in a biosafety hood and with the sash down, and it's very important for it to be down. You can see he can just barely get his hands in there. He's got gloves, lab coat, and he also has a mask on top of the goggles. So there is a risk here of inhalation of the bacteria or virus that could cause disease. This is more like a TB lab or lab that deals with West Nile virus or something like that, that's, could be transmitted through inhalation. So there are a few of those, in at least each state probably has at least one, or area has one of those, is where you send your TB samples to be grown. That would be a biolevel safety 3 type lab. And then biolevel safety 4 are quite rare. This is really what you think of when you think of the CDC and other places. And they deal with really exotic, very harmful, very infectious microbes, viruses, etc. They have a suit that's self-contained with its own air supply. People have to shower in and out, change clothes, etc. So this is the highest level of containment. That's biolevel safety 4. So infectious waste is regulated by OSHA, and it applies to waste that has human blood, human infectious waste, human pathologic waste, and this can also include medical waste, also include animal waste as part of the medical waste. So veterinary clinics would be also subject to that, this in research. Biohazard containers are meant to contain body fluid specimens, including blood. They have to be in a well-built biohazard container with a secure lid. It has to be able to prevent leakage during transport and during disposal. So they shouldn't be punctured, leak, etc. The biohazard bags are plastic bags that are appropriate for the disposal of most infectious waste materials. Like we were talking about, the plates that you would grow bacteria on, those can just go in a biohazard bag. Blood samples can just go in a biohazard bag. But if you have anything that's sharp, you will need an impermeable container for any broken glass or sharps and needles is what would qualify there. Those containers and biohazard bags have to be marked biohazard clearly on there. and bear the universal biohazard symbol. They also need to be the universal biohazard color, which is either orange, orange and black, or red. So most labs generate at least three major types of waste. There's non-regulated waste, so that's just paper, right? Anything that's not dirty, does not contaminate with blood. Regulated medical waste, so that would be what we were just talking about, the biohazard bags, etc. And then chemical waste and even radioactive waste for in the radioimmunoassay lab. And the regulated medical waste that we talk about then is further divided into biohazard waste and biohazard sharps. So sharps have their own container, and both of them are disposed of in the red containers, the red biohazard bags for the biohazard waste, and they are usually picked up by services that deal with, taking it and safely disposing of it for the hospitals. So let's move into the sharps hazards out of that. So sharps are the most common hazard that a phlebotomist will encounter. And you definitely need to always use the safety engineering features. I'm going to show you a few of them here in just a second. Never detach the needle from the plastic tube holder, especially if it already comes pre-assembled. So once it's assembled, leave it alone. Don't take it back apart. Dispose of all sharps or potential sharps in a puncture-resistant container and do so immediately after use. There is danger in putting it down, especially if you put it down on a patient's bed or somewhere where you could forget to dispose of it. Somebody else could grab it. It could get underneath your patient and cause a bed sore. It can cause all kinds of problems. The Needle Stick Safety and Prevention Act was passed in 2001. And it required employers to switch to safety needle devices. So I was working in the lab at that time, and I remember making the switch. We all thought that the safety devices were just kind of in the way because we weren't used to them. I'm so glad they did that because it definitely lessens the injuries. And so this required employers to solicit employees' input in choosing the safety needle devices. There are so many out there. So the ones that were felt to be the easiest to work with for the employees is usually what was selected, and it imposed high fines for failure to comply. This is a picture of some of the ones that we have in our student lab. So we have a vacutainer hub here with a needle, and this pink part is the safety device here. This is a butterfly needle. This part here with the rubber is equivalent to that part, and you would need to attach a plastic hub, like this green hub, to that end. You have to be very careful. There's a needle underneath this rubber, so you don't want to, injure yourself with that needle. And then this is the needle that you use to stick to patients, and you usually hold it by the little blue wings. Once you're done collecting blood, getting the sample, this yellow part can be pushed. It actually, you can push up on it and push it up over the needle and cover the needle so that it's safe, and then you dispose of it. And then, of course, this is a syringe with a needle with a safety device in case you needed to use a syringe to stick a patient. So I'll show you this one right here. The thing with these safety devices, you can actually, so you can move it out of the way while you did a phlebotomy, and you take the lid off, and then stick your patient, and then when you're done, it's activated. You can just press it up like that. And if your hands are full, you can actually also activate this device against a counter. I'm going to use my pen, but you could go like that to activate the device also, and safely cover. That should definitely be done right away once you pull that needle out. That should be one of the first thing to do, is you activate that safety device. And then if your sharps is within reach, you want to dispose of it right then and there. So what's the procedure after blood exposure? You want immediately after any kind of exposure, flood it with water, clean with soap and water, or a skin disinfectant. Report it immediately to your employer, okay? I know sometimes it's embarrassing that you hurt yourself, but it's very important to report because there are protocols that need to be followed, and then you should follow those protocols. Usually it involves testing the employee and then testing the patient whose blood the employee was exposed to. And this is to establish that the employee was negative for, usually it's HIV, hepatitis B, surface antigen, etc. Test the patient to see if that patient has any of those things, like HIV or hepatitis B. If everybody is negative, then usually that's good. Maybe we'll do a follow-up test on the employee to make sure at 3 months and 6 months to absolutely make sure there was no exposure to hepatitis or HIV. If the patient, for example, was HIV positive, then the fact that you document that the employee was HIV negative at the time of the event, and then maybe, unfortunately, if they converted to being HIV positive at month three or six, then it could be tied to that exposure event, and then that could, you know, work into workman's comp or who's liable for paying for the care for the HIV for that employee. Always seek immediate medical attention again and report it if you've been exposed to blood or any body fluid of any kind. Next, we have our physical hazards. So those are pretty commonplace. So avoid running in hospitals and labs. Watch for wet floors. That happens. Things get spilled. Things get cleaned. There are some ergonomic hazards. You need to avoid prolonged repetitive motions. I would say in the lab, as a lab tech, sometimes the problem is like being on the microscope for hours on end and then like hunching over. I know I have some issues with my shoulders from being hunched over a microscope for, better part of 2 decades. You want to bend your knees and lift with the legs when you lift heavy objects or you transfer a patient. You can think of like lifting heavy saline cubes or distilled water cubes. You don't hurt your back. Don't lift with the back, lift with your legs. And then, of course, maintain a clean, organized work area. And then always balance your centrifuges, because an unbalanced centrifuge becomes a mechanical hazard. It can like literally like walk off a counter and fall on somebody or hurt something, break the centrifuge. The last slide, we're going to cover sensitivity to latex and other materials. This can be seen with patients. I would say the majority of hospitals have switched away from latex and are on the nitrile gloves. But irritant contact dermatitis is a reaction to direct skin contact with materials that are left on the latex during manufacturing. The symptoms are going to be redness, swelling, and itching within minutes to hours after exposure. Washing the exposed area can reduce irritation within several hours. So this is what a typical rash would look like. And think of it, it looks, if you've ever experienced poison ivy, it kind of looks like that type of rash. And then allergic contact dermatitis is a true allergic response to the proteins of latex that are absorbed through the skin. Can be a life-threatening anaphylaxis in which the airway swells shut, the heart rate increases, and the blood pressure drops. And in that case, the patient would need an epinephrine injection, or the employee, if the employee is the one that's allergic, and a trip to the ER. Definitely, you can't overlook that. So it is important to pay attention if your patient or yourself is allergic to latex. All right, that wraps up our part 1. There's more to come in our part 2. Thank you.